Big up Spurs fans near and far with your boy Deji Spurs, and I've got a special guest this evening. I've been looking forward to this, but the time had to be right. My bro, my brother from up north, Mr. Toon Tactics himself. Toon Tactics, my brother, how are you? Welcome to the channel.
Thank you so much, and what a privilege it is. And just to say to the chat, it's my fault that we're late. Your man Deji was prompt as always, so it's good to be here. But actually, before I even got into doing what we're doing now, I used to watch Deji quite a bit before that, so it's a real privilege to be on your channel and to be with your chat as well. So respect to you, Deji, and a lot of love and respect to your chat as well. Looking forward to some football talk.
Brilliant, man. No, thank you, Toon Tactics. And likewise, man, obviously, you are the voice of reason. We do the show, the rival show of Asthmatic, and it's a pleasure. And when we had that first, when we first met, I said, no, this is a good guy. This is a good brother.
Thank you.
Who knows stuff, really. So, no, thank you. Thank you for accepting the invitation. So, look, Spurs Newcastle this weekend.
Yeah.
What I like to do with the previews, I like to get a bit of what's been going on. So for me, I just want to get a little sense from you, Newcastle season so far, from your perspective, on reflection, given the sort of injuries, Eddie Howe, all of that. What is your reflection on the season so far?
Well, we came in with a lot of high hopes, obviously on the back of getting to the Champions League after 20 years. The squad, some would say that we got there probably quicker than we expected to, but I say you are where you are, and you know you deal with it. Essentially, we did have a decent squad coming into the season. As you say, injuries took over, suspensions, and illegal bettings, and everything else. But it's all part of the game. It's all part of being an elite team. You guys have been in the Champions League 8-9 seasons in a row, and you know what it is to be able to manage high level European competition, domestic competition, and it comes with it. So if anything, if I reflect on the season, it's the steepest learning curve any team can get.
Yeah.
We've got three guys out of ACL injuries and stuff like that. And like I said, any injury suspensions, but I do think that through it all, we've been very resilient. We haven't kind of dropped heads and down tools and said, we're not doing this and whatnot. We had 17-year-old Lewis Miley in our midfield for a majority of the season and stuff like that. Yeah, and he's just turned out to be a diamond. And so it's a steep learning curve and we're learning from it. And I think coming into this game, for instance, recovery, but at the same time, we've got 11. The form is getting better. I'll end it on this. For instance, so we concede less chances, however, we still concede the same amount of goals, which lets you know that it's the players, there's the quality of players that are out there. But we're here now, steep learning curve, we're enjoying it. Yeah, on to the next one.
Big up. You know what? And for me, I kind of rate Newcastle because you've had to manage. I would say that Tottenham's injury crisis is basically a crisis. But I do look to Newcastle and say, you guys have probably had to manage worse. I mean, people shake their bum for Liverpool and Manchester United, but they have not had the same level. Not in terms of influential players on the squad. Do you get what I'm saying? Influential players, you've probably had the most. And then I would say Spurs have had the second most in terms of missing. Eddie Howe, though, has he managed it well? I thought he'd done a brilliant job with what you guys did last season. I do think, though, it feels like and this is just from an outsider looking in, it looks, I feel like you're the kind of, you know, the backroom staff, the kind of the big bosses are waiting for him to fail so that they can bring in a Conte, they can bring in a Mourinho. And he overachieved last season. He surprised them. They were expecting 8th or 7th so that they could get rid and then bring in Conte or Mourinho. He bloody gets Champions League football. Can't get rid of a manager when he gets you Champions League. And then he's had to manage, quite frankly, a disaster movie. And he's done quite well. Yeah, you're not punching the way you were punching teams. But respectfully, I think Eddie Howe's done a brilliant job. But as a tune, you know, what are your thoughts on what he's doing?
Do you know what? I think you're half right. I think even Eddie acknowledged that he wasn't the number one choice as manager. It was Emery. But he chickened out, essentially. And but what he has surprised them is, Eddie Howe has, in terms of, yes, his leadership, his quality, his level of management through the hard times and the rough. Don't forget that when he took over, we were relegation. We hadn't won a game in 14 games. And after Christmas as well. And so that we're the first club not to only stave off relegation, but to finish 11th, which was actually on Champions League form towards the end of that season. As you know, we carried on that Champions League form into the next season and got into the Champions League. I think, and you might like this analogy, and this is why I have perhaps quite a heavy bias towards Eddie Howe, and I want him to succeed. I liken Eddie Howe to a kid. If, for instance, compare him to Arteta. So I liken him to the way Eddie Howe kind of grew up, obviously, in terms of in managerial experiences, you know, with Bournemouth. He took over Bournemouth when they were like 14 points, 19 points, minus 19 points of and about to get kicked out of League Two. He was their manager, mm-hmm. the sporting director, the scout, everything. He totally, and as a player, he wasn't, you know, he was a player, semi-retired. Was forced to take over because there was no one to take over. So he learned everything from the bottom up. So I liken him to a kid that went to a rundown ghetto school with the teachers, like Gangster's Paradise of school. That's the experience he got in comparison to Arteta. No disrespect to Arteta.
The school of hard knocks, basically. The school of hard knocks.
Whereas Arteta went to the best private schools in Man City and Arsenal, had the best mentors and tutors in terms of Pep Guardiola and everybody else. And he is where he is. And look, everybody grows up differently, but that's why I have such a liking and a strong bias to seeing Eddie Howe succeed. And so I think he's the exact right man that we need just because of experience of his experience. We're a club that also we were on our knees in terms of what Mike Ashley had done to us. And Eddie Howe's got that acute experience that's very, very helpful to where we are in terms of building the club from where it is. I would only, even though my hot take would be that I think he can be our Ferguson. However, he has to prove that. Is he more than just a foundation builder? And is he the guy that can take us to the next level? I think that's for him to prove. I believe that he has the minerals to do that. But obviously, he has to achieve that. He has to put trophies in the cabinet, essentially.
Yeah, but I'm hoping, though, like you said, because he's come from the school of hard knocks, that Newcastle will give him the time to build and bring the players. I think that's that whole debacle with Tonali. How unfortunate. You're thinking you bring in your record signing and then bloody hell, he can't even kick a ball in this season. You know, it doesn't get worse in terms of how unlucky he is. I think what the Premier League is seeing, you know, in these last two seasons are the up-and-comers, the next managers who are going to be dominating. Because I don't see Pep at Manchester United at Man City in the next 5 years. I think he's done what he needed to do. I think if they win the Prem again this season and another Champions League, I think he's, in the next 2 years, he's out. And then, but the ones who are up and coming, Klopp's already leaving. And so it's going to be a new opportunity for new bosses to step in. And I think the likes of Postecoglou, the likes of Arteta, the likes of Eddie Howe will have an opportunity, you and I, to dominate the Premier League. So I think it holds us in good stead. For me, when I look at Tottenham's season so far, I have to say, I mean, look, from an outsider looking in, what's your thoughts on Postecoglou and the job he's done at Spurs before I give you my two cents?
I think, can I go a little bit back? So from an outsider's perspective, looking at Tottenham, I'll say just before you sacked Pochettino, you were looking like the most frightening team in the country. And it was a race between you and Liverpool, really, to see who's really going to challenge Man City. And I guess you came to that crossroads where, you know, you didn't win the Champions League final and all these other things, but you still had the playing style. You had the flair. You had everything going for you. And I know there was a... I'm not a Tottenham fan. Again, I can only look at it from the outside, looking in. A lot of things happened. The stadium was getting built. Transfer money wasn't coming in. And Pochettino was toxic. Was it not toxic? The results didn't come. Whatever the result was, whatever it was, Pochettino got sacked. I think you could have done two things. Either kept Pochettino or get a manager who plays that same style of football, because that style of football was, it was fantastic. And I just thought from an outside looking, I thought it's inevitable before these guys actually take that next level and start putting trophies in the cabinet. But for whatever reason, Levy looked to his right and looked at towards West London and thought, that's how you achieve glory. And he went for Mourinho and all those managers, those counter-attacking...
But you know why?
Pardon me?
You know why, though?
Go on.
Because the fan base will have you believe that winning the Carabao Cup will dampen the noise. And that's my beef with the Carabao Cup. We literally sold our soul to the devil so that we could win that dusty competition. When really and truly what we needed to do was build on the good work, like you said, of Pochettino. Pochettino took Spurs from being nobodies to top six. We are a big six side because of Poch.
Yes.
We were playing regular Champions League football. We started to become well-known around the world. And we bloody... I never thought in my lifetime I would see my club got to a Champions League, played a Champions League final. I know we didn't win, but to say you've made a final, to say you've made a Champions League final, is to be respected. Win, lose, or draw. Do you get what 100%. I'm saying? 100%. But we sold our soul because people were shouting, because people try and shout me down and say, Dej, how can you say that Champions League qualification is better than winning 10 Carabao Cups in a row? Well, the truth is it is. Because if you've kicked ball, you know that the biggest ambition for any footballer, semi-pro, pro, or amateur, is to play at the highest level.
Yeah.
Playing in the Carabao Cup final is not playing at the highest level. Come on! All these dusty people that try and tell themselves that that is good, it's not good enough. So the fact that we were able to get there and do that, bro, is why. But we were listening to the noise, the Tottenham fan base, some Spurs fans were literally saying, if we don't win a trophy, Levy out. Levy don't want to go out. So Levy went and thought, you know what? Let me get the one brother that is guaranteed, will guarantee us trophies. Mourinho, but it meant selling our soul. I mean, that football, the nastiest thing I've ever seen in my life. I mean, it was sandstorms, do you know what I mean?
So, 1,000%, and you lost your identity.
So for that's the reason why. But sorry,
exactly. You lost your identity. You lost who you were for a good, I can't remember, cycle of 4 or 5 years, maybe less. And then, and I think you asked me about Ange, and this is where in relation to Ange Postecoglou, I think he's given your identity back. It's going to take time to realize it, though. And if I was a Tottenham fan, I would look at this season and I look at Ange Postecoglou as the beginnings of growing pains. I was talking to Ash Matic as well about it. And like a lot of the things, the style of play is there. The character, the manager, I think is there. But it's going to take time to mold and wield that together. I'll give an example in terms of like maybe whether people agree on this player or not is beside the point. So for instance, Brennan Johnson, people will say that he's not this, he's not that, he's got no cutting edge. Why did we get him? True, fine. At this moment, it might be true. But you have to, as you look at Brennan Johnson, I think you look the same as this year and really the next 18 months is all of it is growing pains. People were shouting down Anthony Gordon this time last year, saying, why did we buy him? We barely ever saw him. Then he had an incident on the touchline with Eddie Howe and everything else. And people thought, we're never going to see him again. What did we spend $45 million on for? Fast forward now, he becomes England's under-21s, win the Euros. He's man of the tournament. He comes into the season, I can't remember, 10 plus goals, 5 plus assists. My point is, it's going to take time. It's going to take growing pains. And I think because, from speaking to fans, it's because you, at least literally 18 or 2 years ago, you guys were caviar eating, Champions League having Tottenham Hotspurs. And now you're having to rest fighting with the rest of us. And you're also seeing your rivals, Liverpool, all those guys really going ahead of you. And so you're thinking, how are we going to catch up with them with a Brennan Johnson? How are we going to catch up with them with a Timo Werner and whatnot? Even though I don't think Timo Werner's the guy, but in terms of Brennan Johnson, what I'm saying is that you guys are starting that cycle again in terms of where you left off with Pochettino. But the good thing is that you have a reference point. You know, Levy, for all of his faults, still has a reference point in terms of, okay, I can at least know what a good manager is and what our style is and maybe hold on to this identity. So I'll be very, very excited about your future. And like you said, then the gates are opening up with Peps and, well, definitely the clock, exit. So it's all there to play for.
It really is, and I think you're right. And I think what's even more exciting is that where you're even giving Postecoglou a bit of time, Postecoglou doesn't want no time. You know, people chat me down for having too much chess for my club. But did you know, Toon Tactics, that this week Postecoglou guaranteed that Spurs would be in the title race next season? That's the sort of chess that I like. Exactly. So next season, this season was a little rebuild. And he's ready to rock and roll 100%. From next season. That's what I like. That's the chess. I'm not saying he has to win it. But you need to be involved. And the fact that he's coming that way, honestly, I'm excited. It means that the players that he wants, you know, he's got verbal agreements. Tottenham will be bringing in some big ballers this summer. Just don't you know. So a lot of Tottenham fans want to, you know, cuss Daniel Levy. He's spending. As long as he gives Postecoglou what he needs, it's all right with me.
Mm-hmm.
Totally fine. And for me, you're right. We had to go back to what worked. Because I was saying last season that I felt like Tottenham was in no man's land. We're not quite big six because we're not ready to spend 80, 90, 100 mil on a player.
Yeah.
But equally, we're not ready to take a gamble on a 3 million player. We're not ready to spend 3 million on Homer. We're not ready to spend 5 mil on a Caicedo. We weren't willing unless they've been tested. So that's what are we then? We got to choose. And I'm glad that we chose the latter.
Yeah.
You know, Vicario was an unknown. We brought him for 20 mil.
Yes.
We bloody got Van de Ven, bro.
Fantastic.
Under 40 mil. I mean, come on. Fantastic. We bloody got James Maddison for 45 mil. Do you know what I'm saying? You can buy quality without having to break the bank. And that's what we've seen from our gaffer and from the top of the board.
What I'll add to that is that you can buy, like you said, you made a very good analogy, whether it's a £3 million player or £90 million player. What I'm just giving you in terms of identity, at least you know why you're buying them. So there's a famous phrase, he who knows the why can bear the how. So whether you buy a £3 million player or a £90 million player, it's okay because it's okay when you know who you are and what you want. When like you said, you're in no man's land, you don't know whether you've got a hit of a player in front of you or a complete dud.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's what happened with, you know, the likes of Jed Spence and that sort of stuff. But look, I think it's really exciting times for Spurs. I'm really happy with his job. I would have bitten your hand off. If someone told me that come 31 games in, Spurs would be fourth in the Prem. And, you know, I was just on a show with Lee Judges and Dan Potts just a minute ago. And I said to them, and I'm going to ask you, because sometimes I get certain reactions and I do wonder, why am I getting these type of reactions, whether in the chat or... I said to Lee Judges, Spurs are only 11 points behind Arsenal and Arsenal are having a fantastic season. Yeah. I think that's pretty impressive, in my opinion. What's your thoughts on that? Because they were laughing at me like, only 11 points. Only 11 points with the way Arsenal been playing and shaking their bum and we're just 11 points behind in my manager's first season. Come on, that's bloody brilliant, in my opinion. Or do you think that that's a step too far?
I think it's about perspective. Obviously, from you're saying it, we came from no man's land last season to 11 points of Arsenal. That's progress. I think if you're from an Arsenal fan's perspective, you're seeing it as we're playing Champions League, we're competing at the very top, and that 11 points, although it's 11 points in numbers, but I think they're looking at it as in terms of progression, they're certainly a level or a level and a half above you. But it's perspective, and all of that can change within a year, essentially. So I would say this, for instance, for Newcastle, we finished fourth last season. I would say to, and fans will, and there'll be fans that are saying, oh, we don't, Eddie Howe, he's built a rod for his back. He's done too much. I'm like, that's insane. I can't stand that loser mentality. We were the fourth best team in the country. The Premier League, that's what the Premier League table doesn't lie. Whenever I say that maybe to some fans, they're like, they can't believe it. But that's what the Premier League, it's the league. that's how you earn your bread. The table don't lie. It is what it is. And yeah. I think it's just all about perspective. I think probably like myself, that you probably see the glass half full. And some folks see it half empty or even almost empty sometimes. So
in fact, too many folks see it half empty. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Just want to pick up everyone in the chat. Divest. Liverpool's getting slapped up by Atalanta. I almost feel, you know, that Liverpool might be forfeiting the Europa League because they want to focus on the Prem. Big up Sean Lynch, big up ASC always, all of you guys being in the building. Enough respect, enough love. Bro, I need to ask you a question because I'm going to do a video about this.
Okay.
I've been getting trolled. I've been getting re-clipped, videoed because I made a statement. And you're a Newcastle fan. I was trying to speak to this West Ham fan called Lawless, but he's completely wrong. Yeah, he's fully bonkers, man. And this guy thinks he's actually happy with the dusty football that West Ham have been playing. Dustier than Tutankhamun's coffin. But, man, whatever. I said to him that what would you rather? Win 10 Carabao Cups in a row?
Yeah.
Or qualify for the Champions League on a regular? Yeah. Now, I need to get your view because you're a Newcastle fan, so you can kind of understand this. But I want you to speak from the heart and to give the analysis that I know you're going to bring, because I feel like this myth, this mythical beast, this little dragon that people keep saying that by hook or by crook, any silverware is silverware and is acceptable. I need to start crushing it down from now. So you already know my thoughts and opinions, so I don't need to give you. But yes. I need to know from your perspective, you're a Newcastle fan. Would Newcastle fans, would you be happy with just Carabao Cup but never tasting Champions League football ever again? Never seeing the likes of PSG, never seeing the likes of Real Madrid come to St. James's Park, the Barcelonas of this world, the big teams, the big boy players. Is that what you're telling me?
I think for both examples, I think from short to mid-term, it's okay. So it's okay to be continuously in the Champions League and not win cups. But after 5, 6, 7 years, you're going to want to win something. At the same time, after 4 or 5 years of just winning winning league cups or FA Cups, for instance, and not getting into the Champions League and playing with the elites and mixing it with the elites and hearing that anthem, you're gonna want your team to push on and do more. So I think it's all about perspectives. In either scenario, I wouldn't be happy for that to be the status quo for longer than a particular period of time, because in both scenarios, I think the growth is stunted. Why has it stopped? So if I'm always finishing Champions League spot, but I'm never winning the league or I'm never winning cups, why? That's going to be knocking them and everybody else is. Why is that? But if I'm always winning League Cups or FA Cups, but I can never win the big prize themselves, why? What are we doing wrong? I think in both scenarios, I think something's wrong. I think the third scenario is you win League Cups and over time you start getting to the Champions League regularly and challenging for the title. Also, if you're always in the Champions Leagues and doing that, you're also got a squad that's big enough and competitive enough to win the domestic trophies as well.
Yeah. And that's quite level-headed. It's very level-headed, and it's you. You're a classy guy, so you gave a classy answer. Just going to make it a little bit dirty right now. would you shake your bum for the Carabao Cup?
Right now, for this year? This year? You mean
would you shake your shoes?
Of course.
Carabao.
Yes.
You shake your bum violently.
I don't know what that means, but I'll certainly be, I'll desire to win the League Cup, yes.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, you know, my perspective is it's better to love than lost than to never love at all. And I don't know, I saw my team, I saw my club literally fade away from being a big six simply because of any trophy, any Mickey Mouse trophy, even the bloody Community Shield, just to put something on the table and take the naysayers away. And I just thought, nah, I think Spurs and I think Postecoglou really want to go for the big prizes. And for me, every team should be going for the big prize, which is the Champions League, Prem, or at the very worst, Europa League. Every other trophy is dusty, but if you pick it up along the way, so be it. But we won't be focusing on and making it our main aim to be bringing home.
I think you can have both. I think if I was to say to you, do you want Tottenham to be an elite team? I think you'd say yes. I think the ripple effects of being an elite team, where you're always challenging for the number one spot, is the ripple effect is because your squad is bigger, has more depth, you can also challenge for the domestic leagues. That's what elite teams do. So I think you can have your cake and eat. I don't think it has to be one or the other. I think the mistake, for instance, Arsenal made last year was ignoring the Europa League, ignoring the domestic cups, and thinking if we put all of our eggs in one basket for this league, we can do it. But in all these situations, whether small cups or big cups, the common theme is mentality and the willingness to win and the know-how to win, to know that you can do these things. And so the ripple effects of being an elite team, i.e. challenging for the big cups, is that also goes into every other avenue, which is the domestic cups, just even everyday games. So
I hope so. But that didn't quite happen for Manchester United last season, I'm just saying.
You know what Manchester United reminds me of? I don't know if you watch boxing. There's a boxer called Deontay Wilder. He's not very good. He's not very good. He hasn't got a greatest jab. He's not very good at his footwork. But he's got this right hand that has won him world titles. And so because he's got this right hand, he hasn't had to improve much else. And that's been Man United for all this time. That's been their season. They've been winning games they shouldn't. I mean, they've got minus two goal difference at the moment. And they're like sixth or fifth. I can't remember, sixth, I think. Because they've got this wild right hand. You saw against Liverpool. Kwanzaa makes that one mistake. And from nearly the halfway line, Bruno Fernandes does that. I don't think Timo Werner can do that. I don't think Longstaff necessarily can pull that off. But you've got that right hand in Man United. And so...
No, I was going to say Cass and Traps would say that Manchester United have this scummy streak, that they can just scumbag their way. They can scumbag a result, basically. And that's basically what you're saying. They'll scumbag their way to a result. They don't have to be good, but they've got that right jab that they can land it at any time.
Yes.
You know, and that's the thing that scares everybody. But look, Liverpool are 3-0 down to Atalanta. Oh, what the hell is going on here? They're getting slapped up. And I think Liverpool are just trying to focus on the Prem. I think the Europa League is dusty. And I can't, because I can't understand. Atalanta are good, but they're not that good. I mean, come on. I mean, Newcastle will beat Atlanta. I mean, what the hell is going on tonight? But anyway, we'll look back and we'll look into that. So look, this weekend, I just want to get from you quickly, Toon. What is the latest team news for the game this weekend? If they've done the team news in terms of players, and what is likely to be the starting lineup in your opinion, or your preferred starting lineup?
Well, from the jump, it's going to be very limited. For the front three, you're probably going to say Isak, Gordon and Murphy. And for the midfield, it'll be Bruno Longstaff and Anderson, Elliot Anderson. Defense.
Really? No one, there's no one else?
I think Harvey Barnes will be on the bench. So he's a bit of our wild card at the moment. He comes on and scores incredible goals, but he's not fully match fit yet. And I think Eddie Howe likes to have him in his back pocket. I think he's got a slightly maybe longer term plan for the game itself. So if it's tight between us in the last 70, 75th minute, it's good to put on a Barnes.
Okay.
And then Lewis Hall will be left back. Burn, Shaw, and then right back will be Kraft, and Dubravka will be in goal with Harvey Barnes on the bench and a couple of other guys who we don't know will be there as well. Yeah, so
your team is depleted, my brother.
Yeah.
That is a depleted lineup. For me, just I want to answer Sean's question. Did, would you celebrate a domestic cup success? I would take it, but I wouldn't shake my bum. There's FA Cup, Europe Carabao Cup. It'd be like, all right, good, all right, crack on. Where you see me shaking my bum violently, doing a little Brazilian salsa dance, is when my club brings home the big boy prize. I'll take it. It's like, okay, whatever. But, you know, and I'll go to the final and have, you know, make sure I line up and queue up for the burgers and stuff. But I won't be shaking my bum, definitely. But I think Spurs right now, we pretty much have a full squad. It's to do. I do think it's a... Udogie, I think, has been brilliant. Poro, Romero, Van de Ven, what a player. Vicario. Midfield is going to be interesting. I actually said that Højbjerg and Bentancur should start simply because they had a good game against Nottingham Forest and they brought on the points. I do think, though, Bissouma and Pape Sarr might have been losing, might not have been on their A game simply because they've been fasting. And
do you think Andrew play Bissouma and Bentancur?
It's not worked. Bissouma and Bentancur, it's just not worked. I think Pape Sarr is kind of like our Declan Rice. He gets around the pitch. He's the energy. So you could have... Right. Yeah, he wouldn't. It would have to be... He might go Højbjerg and Pape Sarr or Højbjerg and Bentancur, but he won't do both. Definitely, yeah, he won't do both. Okay. Madders will probably start, even though he's not been on form. He's doing this thing where he's starting Timo Werner on the left, but Timo Werner, for me, that make it because... I don't understand the Premier League player that doesn't want to be touched. Like, it's just like, as soon as the right back comes near him, he's like, I got to get rid of the ball. I don't like that. And for that reason, I want him to leave. Do you know what I mean? I'd rather Son on the left, Richarlison up top, and Brennan Johnson. The one thing I will say, though, that Postecoglou clearly is watching us doing tactics, because I know, I've been calling out for weeks that Kulusevski be a direct replacement for Madders. And I went to the West Ham game live. And for the first time this season, Kulusevski was the sub, is sub Maddison for Kulusevski.
Okay.
In the number 10 role. So that might be a little interesting dynamic that we might be able to do against you guys. But I mean, we've got a full squad to work with. And I really don't think your team can do much against that squad, to be honest with you.
We'll see.
I mean, look, can we do what I wanted to do? Let me just quickly answer some of the questions.
Yes.
And then I want us to do Newcastle Spurs 11. And I think we should do Newcastle Spurs 11 if everybody was fit.
Okay.
Yeah, because that would be interesting. Because I do rate the Newcastle squad. But let's see how good you really are. So the Assemble Dark Stew tune. What do you believe the improvements to Newcastle will be for next season?
Well, I actually made a video recently called Raising the Floor. And I think this summer transfer, we will be raising the floor in terms of the technical quality of our players and bringing in players to be able to rotate with our squad. So we're not going to quite buy ceiling raisers just yet.
Is that
because of FFP? Not necessarily because of FFP, just in terms of just our progress and where we are and what we're trying to do. So we're trying to be able to be a club where, say, we do have to sell our biggest players, or if our biggest players get injured, that we've got somebody to replace them in the meantime. Not everybody in every position has to be a star all the time. You just need the players to be able to provide some quality going forward. And so we're going to get a couple... floor raisers. You might see a couple 18, 19 year olds coming in from the Championship, for instance, that people don't know about, for maybe 30, 40 million, and people thinking they've made another mistake, and then they realize, oh no, this guy's really good. So you might see a couple of those type of changes. So I think we'll improve in that end. I think we'll definitely need to improve whatever's happening medically in terms of our injuries. I hope to see that improve. And I think it will, in terms of, I think we're gonna change, evolve from a 4-3-3 side to what you guys do and Tottenham and Liverpool do, which is a 4-2-3-1 side. And our guys, hopefully Bruno Guimarães stays, we'll probably get another one that's of the same ilk who can play back to goal, take it on a half turn too, is pressure resistant type of player. And
I think, exactly.
If you've got £100 million, he may be yours. So, I think that'll be the main kind of improvements. Our style of play, probably getting more possession and add that more depth into the team. I would expect us to be competing in quite comfortably, hopefully, in the top six next season as well, and in all cup competitions as well.
Respect for that. Yeah, I totally agree. Guimarães, what a player. I think if Spurs really want to push on and show their class and show that we want to dance with the big boys, if Guimarães is the type, because I think Spurs are struggling with a six, to be honest.
I think you need a Dewsbury Hall. I don't think you need the Guimarães is going to go to Real Madrid or Man City or PSG type of thing if he does leave. Yeah. When we're looking for the next, I know people might laugh at certain names, but you know,
he's very cool. Is he all right? Let's see. You think
he can do what your other players, apart from Madison, can do, which is take the ball back to goal, take it from the keeper, and drive up with it. He's got the neat passes. Yes, he's not Bruno Guimarães or any other guys that can do that, or your Rodri's, but he's that next level up. That's what, because you've got a structure in terms of how you attack and how you approach teams. You don't need an outstanding classy player who costs £100 million plus. Dewsbury Cole, similar to Madison, will probably cost you 40, 50 million, and he'll do the job that you need to do in terms of progressing the ball forward.
That's an interesting shout, you know. That's an interesting shout. And I think Postecoglou, check him out. Dewsbury Hall, he plays for Leicester City. Big up. Big up to Welsh Owl 1867. It's a big up, Dej, mainly for adding Dusty to my daily vocab. No, I love that. Yeah. The thing is, you can see it though. You know, you see certain teams and just think they're fully Dusty, like West Ham. I got a question from Gavin Watson. He's saying, when do you think Spurs will win a big trophy? I think Spurs win a big trophy in the next 3 to 4 seasons. For me, Postecoglou wants to go for the juggernaut next season. I'm saying it's all right if Tottenham get top four and a Carabao. Then in the third season, we get an FA. And then in season 4 of Stranger Things, Spurs win either the Prem or the Champions League. So I'm giving Postecoglou 4 years. He's in his first year by the 4th, 5th season. And I think it was around about the 4th, 5th season when Klopp won his trophy. Liverpool. So I think 4 years is about right. And actually, it makes sense if you think that season 5 for Arsenal is where we're starting to, you know, Arsenal last season is when we started to take them seriously. And that was four years in. I think round about the 4-year mark would probably make sense. Sean is saying here, quickly on, saying you should come to Spurs for the club and not for top four. That is like a woman wanting to be with you, not because you have a mansion. When he said that, as much as a Spurs fan, I loved the statement and I loved the gesture. I just think a player playing in Germany or Italy or bloody in Buenos Aires or bloody, you know, Rio de Janeiro ain't going to give a shit about Spurs. Yeah, they don't give a damn. Right? What they give a shit about is, are they playing Champions League football and how much you pay me weekly? That's really what it is. That's really what it boils down to. But I think, just like as your missus can learn to love you, you can learn to love a club. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Madders didn't like Spurs. This guy, before this season, was one of the people tweeting some hella rubbish. This guy, you would think he was born a Spurs man. The way he wears that shirt, he wears it with pride. He's the first one beating his chest. And I'm saying, is this the same Madders that was tweeting negative things about my club? It's crazy. So
it's true. It's very true.
You know what I mean? So Jay Greens is another Arsenal fan in the building saying, will Spurs win a trophy and make top four in the next 2 years? Yeah, we'll make top four. I think Spurs win a Dusty trophy. I think, Jay Green, the question is, will I be happy with the trophy that Spurs win? The answer is, I think Spurs win a trophy, but probably not the trophy that I like, not the trophy that I respect. And so for that regard, we will satisfy you, but I won't be satisfied. And then Jay Green's, to quote the famous Toon Tactics, a wise man once said, football is a true humbler. You must win to make top four or season is done. Well, I think even if Spurs don't make top four this season, it's a remarkable season.
Yes.
When you listen to my brother here, Toon Tactics, talked about how dusty Spurs were last season, we would have chopped... Toon Tactics, I'm no joke, and I don't want you to be offended.
Yes,
if you told me at the beginning of the season Tottenham would be in the top four 31 games in, I would have slapped your face.
Yeah.
You know what? There are jokes and then there are jokes. You know what I mean? And it's uncalled for. In fact, I would have gone as far as to say it was unwarranted, that level of optimism for my club. But here we are, 31 games in, and we are in the top four. Even if Spurs were to have a disaster from now on in and finish fifth or sixth, I'd be disappointed. But no one can say that Spurs haven't progressed. And when they asked Postecoglou, what does success look like? He said, success this season, he said, you will know if I've done a good job if the fan base is happy with me. And I thought, you know what? That is so bloody true. If we are cool with what you've done, then that is success, surely. And any Tottenham fan chatting shit about Postecoglou is completely mad. Because what are you talking about? Do you get me? You can't expect him to win straight away. We're not that club. This is not Chelsea. We don't have Tom Bowley. We don't have unlimited funds.
Yeah, and I think whenever I do hear criticisms, I'll say this from Tottenham fans, because I've talked to them, of Postecoglou, I always get the impression is the criticism is in when they compare themselves to other clubs. It's not when you're looking at the process. God forbid if you even say the word process or even phase, people have this allergic reaction, but they're thinking again, they're in danger again of making the same mistake when you've sacked Poch, of looking at the other side and wanting what they have, rather than realizing that what you have right now is also very good. You just need to add a little bit, similar to your transfers. It's not that you don't spend money, you just haven't been able to spend it on the right players to get you over the line. Similar to your team, you're getting to the promised land. You just need to get over into the promised land in terms of winning trophies. You're right there at the cusp, and that's the wrong time to start saying, well, I want what they got, and I want it how they've got it, and I want it right now. And that's when you end up hurting yourself and forgetting who you are.
Yeah. Well, let me just say this. Let me answer Gavin's point, and then we're going to do Newcastle Spurs 11. I'm predicting there's probably going to be six or seven Spurs players, but hey, I stand to be corrected by my bro, Toon Tactics. Gavin Watson, you'll make top four this season. Thank you. Thank you for acknowledging that my team... Because basically, Gavin, what you're saying is after the three Musketeers, Tottenham's the next best team in the country. And I take that. So for me, the fact that you acknowledge Spurs is going to make top four is progress. He says, but you will not win a big trophy no time soon unless you get a billionaire owner. Now, I totally disagree.
Yeah.
What did the billions do for Chelsea? You've got live evidence of billion money doesn't always equate to success.
Yeah.
And Postecoglou showed Spurs, even I'll go as far as to say Newcastle didn't go down that road. You could have, with all the money that you guys have got,
yeah,
you could really flex your muscle, but yeah, you were quite sensible, candid in what you were doing. Gordon, Gomez, you didn't spend big boy peas.
Yeah.
But it was smart. You spent smartly. And yeah, Spurs, Vicario, what a signing. Van de Ven, what a signing. And yeah, Madders, all three of them players, I think, cost us 100 mil. Ah!
Good business.
You know what I mean? That is what you call good business, bro. So for me, it's not about bringing in 100, 120 mil. If you ask a Chelsea fan, was Caicedo good value for money? They will tell you no. You know what I mean? I'd rather we spend wisely. However, this is the thing that I need to see, because I think you're kind of alluding to the fact that you don't think Levy will spend money. If Postecoglou wants Ivan Toney and Ivan Toney is 60 mil, we must spend.
I don't think Spurs want him.
I don't think we do. But I think Spurs want Neto.
Based on some recent news as of yesterday for me, I don't think Spurs want him.
Why not though? Because he's the guy that can do the thing.
There's a couple of things. Again, this is ITK stuff, but you just don't know. Someone's alluded to his medical, but also I think it's more to do with how he goes on in front of the camera. It's one thing saying F Brentford and stuff like that, but we'll be fools if we think that he wouldn't do that to our clubs should he join our clubs.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? It'll be foolish to believe that he wouldn't do that. And I think that's where you got, for instance, you don't hear about Arsenal or Liverpool or Man City like running him down, like, no, thank you. If you isolate his skills and his ability, yes, please. But it's what comes with it that is such a risk. Did you hear about his latest value? 30 to 40 million. So how?
Yeah, I saw that. I thought, how comes his value has dropped so hard?
Exactly. Brentford can't wait for the transfer window to get around. They need to, like, by the time they can sell him, it's going to be 20 million.
Well, part of the reason why his value is so low is because he's publicly declared that he wants to leave.
Yeah.
I mean, so you've given them no room. You've given them nowhere to go. Do you get me?
Exactly.
The whole world knows your guy. Do you get me? So obviously, So I think there's a little bit of that going on as well. But you're right. Actually, I didn't even think about the fact that he's a bit of a loose cannon. Toon, I want to do something now quickly. I'm not sure if we're going to be able to do it now. Okay. I don't want to waste too much time.
No, it's
okay. I wanted to bring up something on the screen and look at the thing, but I think we can talk it through.
Okay.
Spurs, Newcastle 11.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to let you go, and then I'm going to give you my opinion.
Are you bringing something up on the screen?
I'm going to try. If I can get it up on screen, I will. If I can't, let me see. Just give me 1 second. Let me see what man can do. Do you know what? I will play around with it. But if we can get it up, great. But let's assume I can't do it.
Okay.
Yeah. What are we saying then? What are you saying for goalkeeper?
So it will be Pope and Vicario.
I like Pope. I prefer Pope over bloody Pickford for England. I don't know why people keep shaking their bum for Pickford. I think he's rubbish. Pope is much better than him. But hey, what do I know?
Well, I think I'm just looking at some of their stats. It's interesting because obviously Vicario's very good with his feet. Mm-hmm. Pope isn't as good. I think Pope's just slightly a better shot stopper and better in terms of in the air claiming the ball. They're both really good super keepers, but I'll give it to Vicario because of his kind of pace. I think they're both good at it, but he comes out really quickly, yeah, really sharply. So it's all about what you want. If you were to push for Vicario, I wouldn't say no, but I'll just highlight those qualities that Pope does. They're both really good goalkeepers.
Bro, I would have had Pope at Spurs. In fact, I was kind of livid that Spurs didn't go for Pope. You know what I mean? And I loved him. Was he at Burnley before?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought he was awesome. You know, I still think Pope is England, should be England's number one for the Euros. Al Pickford's still in charge. I mean, still number one is just beyond me. But I don't know what anyone sees in him. So I would give it to Vicario only because I feel like he kind of surprised a lot of people in that first 10 games. If not for Vicario, we wouldn't have been top of the league. He came out with some crazy saves. In fact, I would say borderline Alisson-esque. And since then, he's been solid. I think the reason why he's conceded a lot of goals is, one, we didn't have a strong back line in front of him. But also, we play such a high line, which means he's always going to be exposed. That's the only reason.
Has he overcome the kind of physicality in the box? You know, there was that little problem where he was getting a few soft-ish.
I think he's still suspect there.
Okay.
But he has improved. I mean, we did let in some cheap header from, but I think it's an issue with the Spurs team.
That's Pope's strong point. Yeah. So if you've got set pieces, I'm whenever people got set pieces against us, corners against us, I'm pretty calm.
Yeah. Yeah. But distribution wise, you'd give it to Vicario over Pope.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think in the modern game, you do need distribution.
In distribution, you need someone to keep the goals out. So it's 50-50.
Yeah. So what are we saying then? On a personal, I like Pope. So I'm happy to give Pope.
All right.
Even though I think Vicario has been a legend this season.
Fantastic. You know what I mean? Got it up. Yeah. All right.
Big up to Arsenal mannequin, the building, Dej Meister. Liverpool is as dusty as Tutankhamun's coffin. But don't shake your bum too soon, Arsenal manic. Could they be forfeiting the Europa League to fully focus on the Prem? I'm not trying to spoil the party. I'm just saying. So, we're going to go with Pope in goal.
We're doing 4-3-3. I assume we're doing 4-3-3, right?
Yeah, 4-3-3 formation. Yeah. So, yeah, let's change the formation to 4-3-3. And we're going to go Pope in goal. And then centre-back. You know what? I quite like Botman and Schürrle. I think they're both quality centre-backs. Let's go wing-backs. Let's start with the wing-backs and we'll deal with. I think Porro has been standout. I think second to Trent in that right-back position. He's been quality in terms of goals, assists this season. And I think he edges Trippier, in my personal opinion. I think Trippier's been a legend, but definitely Pedro Porro ahead of Phipps.
So, I mean, last year Porro didn't have a great year.
He was playing under a dusty system.
He was playing under a dusty. What would you say Porro's strengths are?
Bro, flying forward. In fact, his biggest criticism was that he doesn't defend or he's not a good defender. But actually, he is. His defensive game is actually quite good. Obviously, there will be the odd time here and there where you can get past him. But going forward, bro, he is like another 10. What he brings to our attacking line flying forward is awesome. And the thing is, when he's not about, you see the drop-off. You really, really see it. When Porro was injured for one game and we brought Emerson Royale in, it just wasn't the same. I think Pedro Porro is up there with the likes of Trent Alexander-Arnold. And I think Man City, there was talk of Man City coming back in for him. He was a Man City player. They let go of him. And no. Pedro Porro is, he's too hard. He's hard.
I'll say this for Trippier. I think Trippier's better all-round player defensively and attacking. He's actually the top assister in terms of fullbacks in the Premier League. This season, but last season was pretty much high up there as well. So he's the biggest assister, creative chance creator. Even looking at the stats, he's better than Porro at creativity, defensively.
He can't do 1v1. Porro can. And that was the reason why Porro is great.
Who was it last year that burnt him when we played against you? I'm not overly worried about Porro 1v1. So in terms of tackling defensively, Trippier is better than him. Technically, Porro is better, but attacking, they're on the same level. I think Trippier is a better all-round right-back than Porro.
Yeah. You reckon? I disagree, man. I really disagree. 1v1 is so important, especially in this day and age. Trippier, I think he does get more assists if you want to do it on stats. But if I give you Trippier, then I'm gonna have to remove Pope and put Vicario in there because Pope is more of a.
You gave your word on Pope. You can't just change it like that.
But this season, how many assists has Trippier got? Has he got more assists than Pedro Porro? He can't have.
Yeah. He's got more assists than Pedro Porro.
Let me just check that real quick.
Here we go, Trippier.
Right. Oh, shit, he's got 10 assists.
Yeah, it's got 10 assists and one goal, yeah.
That's because your team is dustier than Tottenham. Pedro Porro has got 7 assists, which is respectable in my opinion.
It is. And the season's not over yet, so...
How many goals has Porro got? Because I know this guy.
He scored in the last game against Forest. A cracking goal as well.
I think you got to give a weight coefficient to goals, no? a little 2 points for goals scored.
Yeah, but if you want to, you can do. But creatively, who creates the bigger chances? It's Kieran Trippier. Who's the better all round defender? It's Kieran. He's the captain.
Although, can I just say, yes. A lot of Spurs fans probably disagree with me. I didn't like Trips at Spurs. I just felt like I can't stand the right wing back that can't do 1v1. And it felt like every time he would either cross it first time or he would play it back. And that just used to piss me off. So I was glad to see him leave, to be honest. It's not the type of football that I enjoy.
After he played under Diego Simeone for Atletico, all that's pretty much changed. He's improved vastly, and not only skillfully, but also in his character and all that he learned from Diego Simeone. And so it's because of how he talks to Diego Simeone that even my respect for Diego Simeone has gone up.
Yeah. Fair. All right, we'll give you Trips. Bloody hell. I've already conceded two spaces to this dusty Newcastle team. Left back has to be your doggy. I don't think there's anything we need to talk about.
Yeah. Fine.
Yeah, simple. So we're going to put your doggy in a left-back role.
He doesn't...
Go on.
Yeah, go on. No, go on. Yeah, left-back.
I was going to say, centre-back has got to be Vicario and Romero.
You mean Van de Ven and Romario?
Yeah, Van de Ven, sorry.
Yes.
You agree?
Yes, 100%.
All right, you're legit. Although, Botman and Schürrle are good defenders.
Yeah.
But I think they're just a bit, you know, Van de Ven...
He's incredible.
If you want to talk about best centre-backs in the league, I think you say, you know, Van Dijk and Saliba are pretty much on par. And then I think you say Van de Ven.
This might be on par. I need to maybe watch Saliba a little bit more closely, so I'm not going to say too much about him. All I know is that, and this is more of an eye test thing, when I see Van de Ven, I can really feel and see that, wow, this guy is incredible when I'm watching him. And so maybe I have to pay a bit more closer attention to Saliba. I know that he's very good, high-quality player. But I've watched Van de Ven, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 times a season. Yeah. And every time I'm like, this guy is amazing. Yeah, so
he's young. He's only like 21, 22, first season in the Prem. And he looks like he's been there forever. And Udogie, those are two brilliant buys from Spurs. Young players that, you know, if no Real Madrid or Barcelona come in for them, you know, they're here for the next 10 years. They're the type of player.
We keep Pedro Porro there. It's meant to be Kieran Trippier, by the way. Don't try.
Yeah, I'm going to put Trippier. Don't worry. I'm going to change it. Don't you worry about it. Big up to Chinks in the building, you know. Chinks, we're going to do a show after this next week. Definitely. North London derby. I know you're shaking your bum violently, but you're not probably shaking it as much. And he says Van de Ven ain't better than
Chinks, is that him in the balaclava in some park? It's people like you. There's a reason we can't go outside after 6 o'clock.
hey. He's saying that he doesn't think Van de Ven, but I agree with you, my tune, that when you see him, you see that he oozes class. A lot of people look at Spurs' stats and say, oh, you know, he's probably not that guy. But actually, you've got to think, first season, what he does, fastest defender. Rarely anyone... I've yet to see a player get past him.
I don't think in a 1v1, Isak gets past him.
Yeah, I think I agree, mate.
I don't even think Eddie Howe's plan, we'll talk about it later, I suppose, will be... Oh, I can't wait for Isak to be 1v1 against Van de Ven. I don't think that's going to be the plan. So we'll see how it goes.
Real talk. The number 6. Gamera, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay, I thought I was going to have to go through an in-depth discussion about it. Okay, yeah.
Assume has been stray garbage, to be honest with you. The thing with him is he's just up in the club, mate. He's doing some sort of, I don't know, up in the club. Who sang that song? Do you know what I mean?
It's Joe Budden and...
Joe Budden and the Piper. That's really what this guy is all about, his Louis Vuitton. He's just been off ball. I almost feel like he's just been a bit... You know, you can take risks and be a bit complacent. He's a bit too complacent. He should have a bit more fight about him, and that's where Gumerez comes in. He's a bit more a bit more assured, less likely to make a mistake. So I'll take that. So Giant Rabbit says, Come on, man. Van de Ven is a clean-up merchant. Where is he for set pieces when we concede so many goals? Romero is a better defender, technically.
Okay. Then technically, then Van de Ven. I don't know about that.
I think Romero showed us that he's a hot head. I think what you like about him is his aggression.
Yeah.
And yeah, no, Romero, to his credit, he's actually good on the ball.
He is.
Good on the ball and he can distribute. But my thing is about him is he's reckless. And one of the key things about good defenders is being able to time the challenge. And I think I trust Van de Ven in the penalty area than Romero. Romero's more likely to give a penalty away. You know, Arsenal fans shake their bum violently for Saliba, and I see why. He hardly goes to ground.
Hardly.
He wins the ball standing up.
And he doesn't need to make a foul.
He just wins it. And I think that's the sign of a good quality defender. And Van de Ven, that, you know, hardly needs to go to ground as well, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Fantastic. Fantastic player. So Bruno in your number six?
Bruno Guimaraes is the number six.
Okay.
Then I'm going to have to go. I think you got to have Madders in there. I think what Madders did at the beginning of the season was absolutely saucing. I know he's come off form a little bit, but Maddison, when he's on job, he's unplayable.
So the balance is obviously number six who can bring the ball out, and number 10 who can do the final third, which is Maddison takes over. You need a conduit in between that.
Yeah.
I think in my view, that would be Joe Linton. So not only is he an enforcer, he can carry the ball with him. He usually takes about two or three players to challenge him in the first place, which gives space to a Maddison.
Because he's a henchman.
He's an absolute henchman. And that's what takes people away from Maddison so he can do his job. Bruno, for us, you know, Bruno misses him a lot because, you know, Bruno doesn't have to do all of that because Joe Linton is there carrying the ball.
Would you not say he's more of a number six than a number eight then?
Who?
Because it's very weird. He's kind of like a hybrid six. Joe Linton.
He's an eight stroke left wing forward for us. And the reason why he's not a number six is exactly what Bruno can do, which is take the ball back to goal. He's okay, but he's not as smooth with it or as good with it as Bruno is. So if anybody knows back to goal is, you don't have to be necessarily right next to the goal. You could be at any part of the pitch, but your back is facing the opposition goal and you taking on the ball whilst defenders are trying to get the ball from you. And that's the person that can roll. Ask anybody, the reason why, for instance, Declan Rice doesn't do it, he's not very good at it. Odegaard has to drop in and collect the ball from the keeper when they're under pressure. It's not Rice that does it. Odegaard will give it to Rice and Rice will carry it forward. And so that's the part problem that's missing from Rice's game. So Rice, in that respect, is very similar to a Joe Linton. Though I think Joe Linton might be slightly technically better than him. That's just my view. And so the only guy on your team that can do that as well, I think, is Maddison. So Maddison and both Bruno Guimaraes.
Pape Sarr is a sourcing player.
Okay, mate. I need to watch him a bit closer to know.
Pape Sarr, I think, okay, his last performance wasn't great, and I'm prepared to accept that. Maybe, you know, he was fasting as well, so it's tough playing at the top level and you're fasting.
Okay.
But Pape Sarr, for me, is almost Declan Rice-esque for Spurs, but he has the control. And he's been the revelation. Spurs can't. We don't tick without him. We don't tick without Pape Sarr. And I actually get it. I think Joe Linton, what a revelation. He was a striker. He was a dusty striker. That little move there, boom. But I do think that Pape Sarr just edges him, bro. You will see this weekend that Pape Sarr will probably be the best midfielder on the pitch.
But the thing is, you've only seen it in this half year. I've seen it for the last two, well, since Eddie Howe's taken over. Not only in the Premier League, in the Champions League, he's been scoring goals, he's been assisting, and actually we're a far greater team with him. So I think there's a lot more profile. There's a bigger profile for Joe Linton than there is for Sarr.
I hear you. G Mar says, Bentancur over Sarr and Joe Linton. The thing is, Bentancur on paper, look, you're right. On the face of it, he should be over them. But when you're playing the system, Ange Postecoglou is more with Pape Sarr than he is Bentancur. I mean, Bentancur was on the bench against Tottenham Forest. He didn't start the game. Someone of Bentancur's class, as soon as he's fit, he should be starting, and he's not, because he doesn't have the legs. And what Pape Sarr brings to that midfield
is
the legs. And that's why Artillero, I said he's Declan Rice-esque, because what Declan, a.k.a. Basmati Rice, brings to that Arsenal midfield is legs. That's why that's the revelation. That's the change that he's
into that team. I'll say Tonali's better than Sarr. I think, you know, the vice-captain of the former vice-captain.
We didn't get to see Tonali, unfortunately.
Well, you saw him against Aston Villa the first five games. You didn't. So that's how I'm not pushing it too hard. But in terms of, we don't know who Sarr is. We know who Tonali is, the vice-captain of the Rossoneri of AC Milan, Champions League proven. It's Italy international. Joe Linton, Brazilian international, has been doing this in the Premier League for the last 4 or 5 years. The last 2 years have been absolutely incredible. Yeah. Sarr has been okay, and obviously he's got that athleticism. Both him and Joe Linton have got athleticism. But I think Joe Linton not only has shown he's got athleticism, but he's also shown that he can drive forward, he can score, he can assist, and we're a far better team with him.
Fair.
I think Joe Linton over Sarr.
Okay, look.
Let me just check.
I think G Mars makes a good point. He says Bentancur is coming back from an ACL. He had the most legs in our team before his injury. I think I agree with you. Bentancur before the ACL, he would walk this team. But until he gets back to that level, we cannot put him in this team. Not yet. I'm afraid. Not yet until he gets back to that level, and we're yet to see it. And at the moment, whether we like it or not, G Mars, you know, Pape Sarr starts ahead of Bentancur, unless this weekend is where things start to shift. You know what I mean? Things could shift. Chinks is saying, leave Arsenal out of this. We can never leave Arsenal out of this. Basmati, people shake their bum for Basmati and live. We need to relax. So we're going to put Joe Linton in here. I think on the left-hand side of attack, it's got to be Son all day long. There's nothing to talk about.
You're not paying him for the centre?
I think he's more effective on the left, man.
I think you could come to a compromise in the first two. I will put Gordon on the left, Son through the middle, but they could interchange between. So Gordon can play through the middle. Son obviously can play through the middle or on the left.
And then who's going to be on the right?
And that's the thing, because you can't say no to Isak. And you're right.
So what I like to do without the interchanging is Isak up against your number nine against our number.
Okay,
fine. So your number nine is Isak.
Yeah? Yes, he is.
So Isak is the striker for this. There's nothing for us to think about.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But I think as good as Gordon is, on the left hand side, it has to be Son all day long.
What's his numbers for the season, Son?
15 Prem goals. And he's got 9 assists.
Fine.
Yeah, the guy's a madman. And he was away for bloody half the year as well, to be honest. And he's still got those kind of numbers, you know. Yeah. So, you know. And on the right-hand side, who have you got?
It will be... Well...
How does Gordon...
I can play Gordon. I can play Gordon or Barnes on the right-hand side.
Does Barnes play on the right? I thought he was on the left.
And all our players can play across the front three.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. Our option on the right is dusty, to be honest. Kulusevski is just not the guy.
I'll just put Gordon there.
Brennan Johnson is cooking. Brennan Johnson is like rice. We've just washed it and we've put it on the fire, but it's still hard. It's still hard. You know that was. It's not really to be eaten, so definitely not. I think I prefer... I would take Almiron over Brennan Johnson.
Almiron? No. Gordon. Forget Almiron. Gordon. Put Gordon on the right. Yeah. Almiron.
I would take Isak. I think Isak and Nunes would be perfect strikers for Spurs.
But well, Liverpool Nunes.
Yeah, I think he's the way we play would suit Nunes down to a T. But I think the way we play would suit Isak down to a T. And actually, when we lost Kane, I said the ideal replacement for Kane would have been Isak. But with the amount of money that you guys have, we could never, ever, ever get them in the door. So let's say Gordon on the right then. So Gordon on the right. So I think Newcastle edge it. Do Newcastle edge this? Or is it? How many Newcastle players? I think Newcastle slightly edge it. To be fair, though, when Newcastle have their strongest team...
You see left wing, right wing.
Boy, Newcastle, last year, when you slapped us up 6-0, I wasn't even surprised. Because one of the things that when you have your full lineup, you ooze physicality. I think you're like one of the biggest teams. You and West Ham. And you could just tell that our little young men... They weren't ready to play against the Barbarians tonight. You know what I mean? We were going to get Joe Linton, Gomez, Isak, Willock. And then Willock, all these bad men. Nah. It was long for us. We weren't going to do nothing. You know what I mean? We weren't going to do nothing. So I think you're right. I think the Pope Vicario one, in true essence, it could be 50-50. And I do think Porro over Trippier, but you've done. Gavin, I've seen your question. Chill, my guy. Chill. Calm yourself. We're going to get to that in terms of what the
if you look at this lineup, this is a massive height-wise lineup. Very strong, very physical. Got the flair, got the Madison, Bruno Gomez. You're not getting the ball off of them. And
with Madders, you need the Madders. Madders, because Madders with Gomez and Joe Linton kind of in the midfield providing the kind of security job. He will have the freedom to really just float in front of him.
He can be himself.
Yeah, 100%. No, I think that's a fair assessment. But that's not the players that will be playing this weekend, because there is no Joe Linton this weekend against Spurs, and there is no Trippier against Spurs, and there is no Pope against Spurs either. Yeah. So, having said that, we're saying here that Nunes is pants. We need clinical strikers, bro. G Mars, Nunes is a gunman. You know, he is a gunman. It's just unfortunate. It's just not working for him. But with Postecoglou, you think the chances that we give Richarlison, Nunes would miss? Nah, Nunes buries them all day long, mate. He would be licking his lips. What Nunes needs is not Klopp. He needs Postecoglou. That's what he needs. And then Stinks is saying it's still hard. Not ready to be eating crazy. No Diddy. Nunes was shit tonight. Didn't do anything going forward. And who can't hit the target? Okay. Artillery Isak is downgrading to your dusty club. Well, I don't know how it's a downgrade, because after the three Musketeers, Tottenham is the very next best team in the whole country. And even Toon Tactics agrees with that. So, Artillery, I've realized that you are a bot and you are a professional troll. Send me your details in it, and I'll send you a little something, since that's what you like to do. Sitting there in your underwear, bashing away at the keyboard, you know, like that. That's what you do. So anyway, moving forward, the prediction for this weekend, Mr. Tactics. Given your lineup that you've said, given the way that you've been playing recently, what are you predicting for your team?
Well, look, Tottenham are our favourites to go into this tie in terms of just your overall play. Our form isn't too dissimilar, especially in the last five games, but you are playing really well. And that's what I saw from the Forest game. And you've got more depth, especially coming off your bench. Where it could fall flat for you. So I think the main threat comes for you, for us, would be down you guys overloading or overlapping on the wings. You know, we've got Hall and we've got Kraft. And yes, Hall is good on the ball, but he's still learning his defensive skills. And so you could really, really hurt us, in particular in terms of how you get to the byline line and you do the cutbacks. What impressed me in the Forest game, I know people are frustrated with the first half, but you made the changes in terms of your midfield and you slowly ground down Forest and you just kept on peppering them and they just got exhausted, because they were doing defensively quite well, but they just got exhausted. I did though study the game that you guys did against West Ham, and I wondered how West Ham, who also play relatively low block, but when I saw the average positions, they actually played mid block against you guys. But they also they didn't just defend, they did have decent outlets through, especially Kudos, who was their man of the match, and through Bowen. Yeah. And so in order to be Tottenham, you need a bit of, you need both of the, and it sounds simplistic to say, but you need defensive discipline, but you also need to make them scared of what you're going to do going forward, which Forest stopped doing. And so I think that's how West Ham got away with that win. And so Newcastle, I've got to remain tight on the overlaps in particular at the back, but we've got to carry that threat, which we do through Gordon, Isak. We did it pretty well when we played against Man City.
Gordon, Isak and who, though? Who would be the person on the right?
It would be Murphy, but I think by the 50th, 60th minute, Harvey Barnes will come on. And he's been a game changer for us a lot of the times as well. Unless Howe puts him on at the beginning, so you've got Isak, Gordon and Barnes right at the beginning, then I'm thinking Howe's looking to go at you in the first half, which would be interesting. I think we'll do a mid-block, and I think we would try to ensure that we limit you on the overlaps, and we've got a very limited bench. We have to be remaining threatening. We've got a very narrow path to victory, put it this way. And if we limit you on the overlaps and we can keep it 0-0 or 1-0 coming into the 70th or 75th minute, we can either get away with a draw or a win if you don't convert your chances. That's the main kind of doubtful bit with your guys is, can you, because it took Porro and Van de Ven putting it top bins, deservedly so, but putting it top bins to win it for you. So that's the narrow path to victory for Newcastle, but I think the Tottenham do come in favourites.
Quick question. Will you have a stronger team this weekend than the one that beat you guys 4-1?
Good question.
Because this team is looking kind of suspectish from my perspective.
We had Lewis Miley, Longstaff in midfield, whereas this one we've got Bruno Elia Anderson, who's better in tight spaces and playing, and we've got Harvey Barnes back. We didn't have none of those options when we played you last time. Burn looks better left centre. I see this team's slightly better, and at home.
Yeah.
So that's the advantage. I don't know how you guys are psychologically, mentally. You're better. We've actually, both our teams have scored the same amount of goals this season. So GF scored 4, which is interesting. And we've conceded 7 goals more than you. So on paper, it's a little bit closer in certain aspects. But that will be it for me in terms of that. So this team is slightly better. We've got home advantage. And if we limit you and frustrate you and you don't have a great first half, and say, for instance, I want to see how you respond if we got a goal up, for instance.
Yeah.
Say, like, first 5 minutes of the second half. What's going to happen then? Are you going to overextend, which you seem to do when you go away? When I was looking at you guys' average positions, you overextend at home, actually, but you do it comfortably. But you're a little bit more conservative when you're away, which is interesting.
Yeah.
So, that, like I said, I think you guys are favourite, but I think there's a narrow path to victory for us.
I think I have to agree. I think Tottenham go there and we win 2-1.
Okay.
I think, though, what Tottenham need to do in order to get the points, and they didn't do this against West Ham, but I know Postecoglou is a big fan of the channel, is that the reason why we drew with West Ham is because we didn't go physical. So we played Timo Werner. Timo Werner didn't want it out left. I think Son needed to be out left. And I think Richarlison needed to be in the middle, roughing up the Kurt Zoomers, roughing up the Suchets of this world, because these guys are just man mountains.
Richarlison's not fit for this game, is he?
What's that?
Richarlison's not fit for this game, is he? Which I'm
quite happy. Is he not fit?
Yeah.
Is he not fit?
Yeah, I looked on FOTMOB, he's doubtful.
Okay, and he's doubtful, but I'm hoping he'll get over the line, because, I mean, he hasn't been getting much.
He's the key, funny enough.
Yeah, he didn't play against Nottingham Forest last week. So, but I think in terms of what we need to do is if Gumerez is playing, then Bissouma will start, because we're going to need to match physicality. And Bissouma, I'm not going to lie, he is a brawler. You know what I mean? And Gumerez needs a fellow brawler to kind of settle him down. Because if Gumerez knows that he's got the physical advantage, that's when you guys go forward. I've noticed that. Physicality plays a part when you're watching these games in midfield. And Bissouma will probably start for that reason. And then Pape Sarr, he would be there to nullify your other guys. So I can see Bissouma and Pepe start starting, even though I think Bentancur and Højbjerg deserve to start. Your doggy, whoever you got on the right, Murphy or Harvey Barnes or Gordon, none of them are getting past it. I mean, your doggy put Saka
Gordon
and...
Can't get past the doggy.
They're not getting past your doggy, bro.
Okay.
Your doggy will barge Harvey Barnes into the stand, bro. It's like light work.
Your doggy doesn't like to backtrack. I was watching them against
that. Oh, your doggy said to Saka at the Emirates, race me then. Race me.
Yeah, Saka. That's Saka. That's Saka.
He don't want it. Do you know what I mean?
I'll look out for that.
Let's see. And then what? Have you got Dan Burn as your left?
Left centre back. So left back would be Lewis Hall.
Lewis Hall against Porro.
Put it this way, you will overload on that left hand side and the right hand side. Your biggest problem is that if for whatever reason you make a misplaced pass, just one misplaced pass, and we get the ball to Bruno and he spreads it to Gordon, he's going to fill that gap in between behind Porro. It's going to be Gordon and Isak against trying to isolate either Ramos or Van de Ven, and it could be very dangerous times for you. So that's the risk that you take in playing that way. And I think that's our way.
And that is our strength. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I just think that the one thing I will say also is that we will have more ball possession.
You will.
As well. And that will play, because your guys, you can only be effective if you have the ball, and you won't have that much of the ball, not with that lineup.
But you're not a patient team, though. You were in the second half against Forest. I don't think you like passing the ball for the sake of passing.
No, the biggest issue with Spurs is that we overpass. We have become old school Arsenal. We get to the final third, and instead of shooting, we pass, and then we lose the ball. But what we saw in the Nottingham Forest game was that we just bloody took a shot. Van de Ven took a shot. Bloody Porro took a shot. Game done. As long as Tottenham, when we get to the final third, as long as we test the Bravka, we could smoke you guys at home. Okay. But if we do this idiot thing where we get to the byline and then we're going to do this little side to side like it's the candy dance, that's when it could get long. Because it just takes, like you said, it's that one misplaced pass, through ball into Gordon, through ball into Barnes or Isak, 1v1, and then it could be long and it could be long. Spurs have to shoot. We have to shoot at the byline. If we don't, it could be long for us.
Were you guys like away from home?
We've been okay. It's not been fantastic, but it's no different to our home form, to be honest. I think it's much of a muchness. I can't say we're weaker or stronger at home or away. It's just what it is. I think it's almost a bit equal.
Okay.
I think we've lost more games at home than we have away. I don't know. G-Mars, have we lost more games at home or away? That's a good question. But look, we're not going to the St. James's Park fearful. We're going there to take the 3 points.
Yeah.
The other thing I would say, lastly, before we wrap up, is that Spurs struggled to get it up against the Minnows. We struggled, bro. I ain't gonna lie to you. You
know, we're the Minnows, yeah.
No. This is where you'd be delighted to hear.
Okay.
We respect Newcastle. We think this is a big game. We're taking this game serious, a bit like the Villa game. Do you get what I'm saying? So because of that, and we've done well against the big teams, it's the little teams that I would be more worried about. So I think Tottenham go there and we get 2-1.
I'm going to say Newcastle 2-1. I think you will struggle with the atmosphere. You'll get frustrated. This is more in terms of this. I'm going for the narrow hope to victory. I think for whatever reason, Hall and who's our right back, Kraft, get it together and we're able to limit you on the sides. You'll try to go through the middle, but it'll be difficult. And that misplaced pass, you make it, and for some reason or another, every chance that we get in front of your goal, we manage to convert it, and that's going to frustrate you. You're going to overextend, you're going to put your boys up even higher, and you're going to pay the price even more, and the crowd's going to be on top of you.
Let's see. It's a possibility, but let's see. I just want to deal with one person, and I'm going to do a phone-in show next week, because this brother, I need to see this Artillero, because I think... he is a walking demon. I don't actually think he's a real person. So let's deal with the thing right now. So he said, you haven't done well against the big teams. Stop lying, FFS. Let me remind you, Donut, that we beat Liverpool. We drew with Arsenal away. We drew with Man City at the Etihad with a depleted team. We lost and beat Aston Villa. We beat Newcastle. We lost to Chelsea with 9 men. What part of that is not doing well against the big teams? Exactly. Artillero, I realise, look, with the greatest respect, there's trolls and then there's donuts. You're a donut. So, yeah, moving forward for next week. And you know what? I'd like to meet you, Artillero, on a level. I would love to meet you and I'm going to do a phone-in. Please have the kahunas. Please put your clothes on and make sure that you join that show because I would love to meet you and have a little debate. But knowing you, Artillero, that's the day that you're probably going to be working late because you don't want it. That's what it is, really. You just don't want it. So, look, G-Mars, I'm with you. I see all the stuff that you're saying in the chat. Big up to you. Big up to the Assemble. Big up Artillero. Big up Gavin. Big up to everyone that's been in the building. Toon Tactics, what a show. What a preview. Do you know what I mean? Thoroughly enjoyed it. Got a bit of understanding about your club. Tell everyone where they can find you, my bro. I tell
everyone. Guys, you can find me on YouTube, on Toon Tactics TV, as well as on TikTok, Instagram, and X. I did recently send a preview video of our game as well, but you've got it live here as well. So that's great. And I guess every other Wednesday, really, I'm on the Spurs Kings as well with Ash Matic, your boy Deji. We're on the Rival Show. We have a fantastic time, guys. And if you guys don't come to that show, it's a brilliant, brilliant show. So do come on it. That's where you guys can find me.
Big up, Maggie. Thank you very much. Look, big up to everyone. Look, Toon, I really think we need to do a quick reaction, if possible, after the game. But let me know. We can talk about it after. Thank you for tuning in. Big up to everyone in there. Thank you for staying with us. And we are out.
Take care.